In this video, we're going to show you how to make sure Zoom settings are safe. We're going to hack your Zoom privacy settings to ensure that Zoom bombing doesn't happen to you. Let's get started. Hey everybody, welcome to Mr. Cook's Corner, education for educators. We're all about helping teachers grow in their craft. If this is your first time watching, welcome aboard. Be sure to like our videos, subscribe to our channel, and share this with a friend. So I'm sure we've all heard by now that these Zoom meetings that teachers are using online are easy to get hacked into if not set up correctly. But what is the exact settings that you need? To tell you the truth, it's really not that hard to do. All it takes is just a few simple tweaks right up front and you'll be set from here on out. So let's take a quick dive into your Zoom privacy settings and get you all set up.
Okay, before we get started, I just wanted to point something out. If you go to the description below, you're going to see a link to my Zoom settings guide. It's a free download. I've got it up here on the screen for you. You can grab this anytime. We are logged on to the Zoom website, and the first thing you're gonna do is you're gonna click on my account in the top right corner, and you'll see here, it just pops you up into your profile, but what we wanna do is we wanna go down a few tabs and we wanna click on settings. So what I'm gonna do is scroll down from top to bottom and work through these, but what I want you to do is to pull up a tab next to this video and follow along with me. As I scroll down, I'm gonna skip over things that aren't related to your security settings because there are a lot of settings in here. However, I will be sure to highlight anything that has to do with security to make sure you're set up to go. The first thing we're gonna do is turn off join before host. We don't want anybody coming into the room before you. This next section I want to look at is personal meeting ID. It's also called PMI. It's basically your own virtual classroom. I personally recommend that you turn this off. If you continue to set all your meetings in the same room, other people are going to be able to eventually log on to that whenever they want. Instead, when you do turn this off, it's going to generate a random room key and a room number that's different each time. Moving down to only authenticated users can join meetings, you want to turn this on. And all it does is make sure that when someone comes into your meeting, they have an account with Zoom. Now you can get real deep and turn that into something else. You can actually limit users to certain domains. You can make sure they have to have a certain address that they come from. We don't want to get into all that because right now your students and your parents that you may be conferencing with are going to come from all different types of places. For now, we just want to focus on making sure that they have a Zoom account when they come into a meeting. Now for this next one, it depends on where you work and who you work for. As you can see here for me, it's been locked and it's already turned on. But if not, you're definitely gonna wanna turn on required a password for an instant meeting and also require a password for a personal meeting. Now don't worry, people aren't gonna have to type this in. You're gonna be able to activate something later to where it's embedded within the link. For most of us, this is already turned on. If not, do so now. And the very next one down, just like I said, is embed password in meeting link for one-click join. You turn this on and what it does is it puts the password into the actual link. If you don't turn this on, people are gonna have to type in this password. It's a self-generated password. You can change it anytime. I'm going to be changing this after the video, but that's just an extra step. If you want people to do that, that's your choice. But if not, make sure you turn the embed password on. Moving down to the next section, you're going to want to turn on mute participants upon entry. So that means as you start meetings, when people come in the room, they come in already muted. So you don't have to continually mute people as they come in. These next three I like to batch together. Now I turn chat on and you're going to obviously want to do that as well. But the key thing underneath that is to turn private chat off. If you turn private chat on, that means people can send individual messages to each other that doesn't go to the main board. You could be hosting a meeting and two students could be sharing messages back and forth and you wouldn't even know it. So make sure to turn that off. Right below that is auto-saving chats, and I also turn that off. For most part, you're not gonna wanna save your chats. The only time you would is if you have important links to things that you're gonna wanna save for later, but if that's the case, you can do that manually. So for here, we wanna make sure that the auto-save function is off. This next one's big, and it's a little bit debatable depending on your level of comfort, but for file transfer, I recommend you turn that off. Now maybe you're having a PLC or a team meeting, and it's just you and your group. You may turn that back on so you can share documents with each other, and that's totally fine. But when you're with students, let's make sure that's off.
Before we continue with the rest of the video, I wanna ask a quick question. Are your school districts even letting you use Zoom right now? Are you allowed to video conference with your kids? Let us know if so, let us know if not. Post in the comments below and tell us about your experience. We're all about collaboration here and it's time to make some connections.
Moving down, you're gonna wanna activate co-host. That's gonna allow you to add other people to share hosting responsibilities with you. This is good because you could have another person managing the chat and managing the mutes and the unmutes and the hand raising while you're focusing on teaching your class. So be sure to turn that on. However, moving down from that, for screen sharing, yes, you wanna activate this and you wanna turn it on. However, you only want to have the host have the ability to share. You want to make sure that you do not click on all participants. because if you do, any student could then hijack your meeting and share the screen. Right below it, it says disable desktop screen share for users, and I don't want you to get this confused with the screen sharing bit. They're two totally different things. You want to turn this off. We're not trying to disable screen sharing for other people. What we're trying to do in this one is you're only allowing certain applications to be shared. And in this case, you're going to be the only one doing the sharing, so you don't need to activate this. Below that are some tools that are really functional for Zoom, the annotation and the whiteboard functions. I recommend that you turn them off unless you specifically know that you yourself are going to be using them to teach a lesson. Now, perhaps you're recording a meeting by yourself for a lesson and you need to use these tools, that's fine. But when you're in a meeting with lots of students, you want to make sure these are turned off so nobody can hop in and use them. Moving on, we're talking about allowing removed participants to join. This is not talking about people who lose their connection or have to log off and log back on. We're talking about people that you actually remove because they can't behave or they're being unruly. If you remove them and you disable this function, they will not be allowed to get back in the room. So this is definitely something that you want to turn off. However, right below that is a really cool function. It's called allow participants to rename themselves. We turn this on because when we have meetings with students, a lot of the times we want to organize them in numerical order. A lot of elementary classes especially, they have their classroom numbers, and you want to be able to easily access your participants on the side. So when you do this, you can tell them, hey guys, go in and rename yourself. We recommend you do it with the number that they are and then their first name. So for example, if John Allen is number one, he would put 1-John. And that way, when they all do this, you'll have a nice, neat list of kids who you can order, and that way you can find them a lot easier. We also find this important because a lot of times students log in with their parents' account, and when you see them in the chat room or when you see them on the participants list, it's listed as their parents' name, and it's a little bit more difficult to find. So this is really useful. It's safe, it's secure, and it's a better way to organize and know who's in your room. Scrolling down, one thing you definitely want to make sure you have turned on is the waiting room. That way nobody can get in the room before you. If you're in there and you're not ready to start, you don't have to let people in. This is another example of having a co-host manage a part of this for you. That way they can see who's waiting and they can determine whether to allow somebody in or not. But if you turn the waiting room off, people can just hop in without you admitting them and they can get in there before you. So make sure you activate this. That's it for the meeting section. We've only got a few left under recording, so go ahead and head over to that next. We want to make sure we activate local recording. This allows you to record your meeting, but you want to make sure that you check this box here, giving participants permission to record. This way it can't happen automatically. You know who can and who can't record, and you give them permission to do so. This comes in useful when you're sitting in specific meetings such as 504 meetings or ARD meetings where you're going to need to record things legally and you need to give permission to other parents or other professionals who need access to the meeting. But this way students can't record without you giving them permission. So this is also really big. Right below that is automatic recording, and we turn that off. If it's on, it's going to start recording whenever you start a meeting. Eventually this takes up a lot of space and it's just a waste of time. So make sure you turn that off. And the last thing we're going to look at is only authenticated users can view cloud recordings. You want to turn this on. This way you can manage who can and can't see the recordings once you've downloaded them. Here are some general best practices for you to remember. Make sure you always assign a co-host to manage. Make sure that you mute all participants when they enter. Once you know you've got a full room full of everybody that you need, lock the meeting. That way people that you don't want can't come in. Again, make sure you turn off your file transfer, and then finally have participants rename themselves to your liking. If you followed along with me so far, you're not gonna have to do any of this because you've already activated them in your settings. And if that's the case, you are all set to go.
As always, we hope you've enjoyed our content today. If so, please consider subscribing, liking our videos, tossing some comments down below. You guys are the lifeblood of our channel, and we wouldn't be able to do this without you. Also, check us out on MrCooksCorner.com. We're on Twitter, we're on Facebook, we're on Teachers Pay Teachers. You can find us just about anywhere. Till then, see you next time on Mr. Cook's Corner. Bye.